here tonight to receive presentations. Is that agreeable to the council?
Fine idea.
Thank you. Okay, in that case, let me start with... Going over here. Okay, we're going to be recognizing the Cape Little League, ages 9 and 10. And the way I'd like to do this is to ask Cam Brown, Evan Lovato, and David Danklus, and all the players, come right on up here so you can be seen at home on the... Okay, first one you have both sides. Now, if you guys went on TV up in Bangor, what you got to do is you face the camera up there, and then the people at home will know who you are.
Can't wait.
All right. Now, I'm going to read a commendation, if I may please. Whereas the youth of the town of Cape Elizabeth have a long tradition of participation in Little League Baseball, which began in Maine here in Cape Elizabeth, and whereas the Cape Elizabeth ages 9 to 10 All-Star team on July 29th traveled to Bangor to participate in the Maine Little League All-Star Tournament, and whereas the team scored 6 runs in the first inning of what was their 6th game in 6 days, and whereas the final score of the game was 12-0, thus earning the team the State of Maine Championship, and whereas the team won this game and those that preceded it as the result of many talented young players who practiced and trained hard to reach their goal of being champions in Maine. Now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth ages 9 and 10 Maine Little League state champions, their coaches, their managers, and their parents on winning the honor and distinction of being the best age 9 and 10 Little League players in Maine, dated this 10th day of August. Congratulations. Would you like to receive this and say anything? Well, you may receive this and I didn't want to say anything or not. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. I just want to say that I just really appreciate having Evan Lovato and Dave Dankos here, and there's also a few other people John Casey and Kerry Curtis and a few others that really helped us throughout. Steve Martin and my wife, Sally Barker, who really helped us out because it was a lot of work and a lot of training. We practiced 2.5-3 hours a day in the heat, and these kids didn't complain, and they loved to play. And this is a great group of ball players. And I think as they get older, you'll see that the accomplishments will continue. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to balance act here and hold these awards at the same time that I find my glasses. Now, also recognizing tonight, we're going to recognize Aaron Maloney for the Conservation Commission Essay Contest winner. Is Aaron here? Oh, come on up, Aaron. Now also, as a runner-up, Emily Karras. Is she here tonight? She may not be. Okay. And I've also got a list of some other folks who may have done some work here that I want to just mention. Linda Francesconi, Mary Ann Casey, Carolyn Sloan, Paul Casey, Joe Doan, and Kathleen Walsh, who all helped with the program. Thank you to all of you. All right, thank you. That completes the presentations. We'll now move back onto the agenda and go to the citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Are there citizens wishing to speak tonight? Ms. LaValle, would you come up to the podium, give your name, why you're here, and explain to us, please, what you'd like?
My name is Paul LaValle, and I am president of the Cape Elizabeth Youth Football Program. At the suggestion of the Fort Wayne's Advisory Committee, I'm here before you tonight to make a request for the use of Fort Williams, where t-ball and softball are played for football practice. We want to use that until September 5th, which is when we will be able to use the field assigned to us, which will be the outfield of the softball field on the high school campus. At this point, there's a moratorium on the usage of fields, and we are practicing at Lions Field presently. Okay. Now, this is a new group here in town. We have, rounding figures off, we have 50 players in the 8 to 12-year-old age group. We have approximately 20 players in the 7th and 8th grade group. We have 20 cheerleaders in various age groups. This is the group that, at this point, is the Cape Elizabeth Youth Football Program. We are entered into two different leagues, and our first game is September 5th. One Cape team will be playing the other Cape team in the 8 to 12-year-old group. As I say, we're using Lions Field at this point, the only field that's been available to us. A regulation football field is 100 yards by 53 and a third yards. Lions Field, the biggest dimensions you can get would be 30 yards by 31 yards, and I've tried it every which way, trust me. You know. It does not give us enough room to properly teach the game. We can't teach a passing game. We certainly cannot teach the kicking game, where there's a kickoff, there's a reception, there's a whole aspect of the game that we'll be going into our first game completely unprepared for, but it's at a distinct disadvantage competitively. Now again, there are new fields being built in Cape Elizabeth, and Sue Weatherby has told us that one of the new fields under construction would be ideal for football as we continue to grow. But our immediate need is we need some space between now and September 5th. We have been practicing 3 days a week at Lions Field. So that's why I'm here, simply put. Some issues that maybe are of a concern, for example, insurance. We are a properly insured organization. We have with us now our insurance certificate. Sanitation issues arise. We will be happy to increase those that are presently in existence at Fort Williams. Damage to a field. In 3 days of practice at Lions Field, there is no damage. I do have a letter from Bob Malley, who inspected those fields this morning, we'll make that statement that there has been no damage to the field. I mean, these are young, I told you what the age groups are. There was not enough physical force to tear up turf the way that the NFL or college games do, you know. Would you agree? that's it. We need to try to move forward with this program. It's here, everyone's having a lot of fun, and we just need some more space. And as I say, I was here at the request of the suggestion of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, who was not able to act quickly enough. Please, fire questions at me, reasons.
Questions for Mr. LaValle? Yeah. Yes, Councilor Berry.
Which field in Fort Williams?
Okay.
The parade ground?
Yeah, what they call the parade ground, which traditionally is the athletic field for the soldiers many years ago when I grew up in this town. First Cape Elizabeth Little League team, I helped build the fields, but be that as it may, the only field we could play on was where St. Albans Church is, you know. But that parade ground field that has a tradition of athleticism to it for the soldiers, that's what we want to talk about.
Why is there a moratorium on it? Because of chewing up?
No, there's a moratorium on the fields on the campus. On the school, because they've been seeded,
right,
Resodded, and they're just resting them.
They want the grass to get a chance to take hold.
Absolutely.
But this is not a problem at Fort Williams.
This is not a, there is no moratorium on Fort Williams, no. It's only, there's only a moratorium on the usage from any of the high school fields or, okay.
Other questions? Councilor Reed.
Stop me if I become inappropriate, as I sometimes do. In the past 3 years, we've been asked to expand the athletic recreational program for youth in this town because of the increased interest. And to me, I think the fact that the people who participate in your program pay a fee, sir.
I'm sorry, say this again.
The people who participate, the youngsters who participate in your program, do they pay a fee?
Yes, they do.
To have 70 students or children between the ages of 8 and 14 participate in what is a new sport to Cape Elizabeth, and then the opportunity for 20 cheerleaders. I remind the council that we've also expanded the Nordic and the cross-country ski team and the women's lacrosse team, and we added a volleyball team, which was short-lived. And I think that we owe it to organizations, when there's the volunteer support, to be the coaches, and the parents are willing to pay the fees, and we have enough participants to field a team, that we have a responsibility as a town council to find the places, if it's at all possible, within our boundaries, so we don't get into the issues that we did with the girls lacrosse team, having those students go to Portland until we could find a place. I am concerned, though, the reliance on the fields that are under construction, that's 2 years away, isn't it? In the meantime, if I were to vote for this, would you understand that there would have to be some fundraising done on the part of the football boosters to participate in the paying for these new fields that are under construction and planned? Would be my first question. And second, understand that if I did vote to approve the Fort Williams field, that you would understand that that would be temporary?
Yes, I understand that would be temporary, and certainly we want to jump in and do everything that we can to make things go forward. I mean, the fundraising aspect, we're doing that to get ourselves off the ground. We feel that we are very capable in that, and certainly want to participate and be leaders in that area.
And only to have the 9 and 10-year-olds that we just saw here as the beginning of the feeder system. I also know what 13 and 14-year-old boys become, and some of them would double the size of the youngsters that we've seen here today. So in case there were any damage as this progresses and as there is rain, et cetera, would your organization be willing to pay for the damage to have the fields repaired?
Yes, we will pay for the damage. We will take care of doing that ourselves. If you give us the permission, we want to improve those fields. We have people waiting to do whatever improvements you'll allow us to do.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate the questions.
Councilor Watson.
Mr. LaValle, would you please explain to the council where you're currently going to be playing your games? And a little bit about your schedule, about who you're playing and the type of organization you've put together.
Okay. The field that has been assigned to us is the outfield of the softball field on the high school campus. Okay, we have that on Saturdays and Sundays from 1 o'clock on. This is according to Sue Weatherby, Keith Weatherby, in conjunction with Mr. Malley. All right, that takes care of that. That's where we're going to be playing. Our first game, okay, there are two leagues. Am I talking properly here?
All right. Yep.
There are two leagues. One league is the Greater Portland Youth Football League. Okay, that is the 8 to 12-year-old league. That is a new league. It's an offshoot of a program that's been going on for quite a while in Portland called Little Lad Football. So it's the Greater Portland Youth Football League. There are three teams there. There's one team from Falmouth, and Cape Elizabeth has two teams. Okay. As I say, our first game is September 5th, and it's an 8-game schedule. I did leave our initial news newsletter with the council. It's got a schedule on it. The other league is the Southern Maine Youth Football League. This is the 7th and 8th grade. These are teams from Gorham, Windham, Scarborough, York, Kennebunk, Wells, Arundel, Somersworth, New Hampshire, Marsh Woods, Bonnie Eagle. There's an A group and a B group at this point. We're in the B group for the reasons that we're new and small and all those things. You'll see quickly, but forget that. That's only me. And our first home game in that, and that league is played on Sundays. So it's the Saturdays is the Greater Portland League. Sundays is the Southern Maine Youth Football League. Have I answered everything, Ms. Watson?
Yes, you have. Thank you.
Okay.
Other questions? Councilor McGinney.
Two things. First, a clarification. You say you only need this field until September?
Until September 5th. At September 5th, the moratorium is over. We're able to use the field. Okay, what we're looking to do is, I don't want to have our boys play a September 5th game with never having had the opportunity to field a kickoff or a punt or to get lined up or any of that type of thing, which is difficult at Fort Williams. We've got three teams practicing in a compressed area. So.
My second question, I don't know if it's for you, or what happened with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission? Was there?
Okay. Made the presentation last month to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee asking them the same question I'm asking this evening. Procedurally, apparently, we should have been there in February. Because we were not there in February, the Fort Williams Advisory Committee felt that they did not have enough time to allow for public discussion or public disclosure or any of those concerns. Apparently, they were somewhat sensitive to with the other two fields that have been built. I guess it's been a three-year process, and they were sensitive to those people in Delano Park and the Sherwood area, and et cetera. With that in mind, I started polling these people. I just drove in the car and got out and talked to people, and I said, this is who I am and what we're doing, and we need a place to practice, and if it were to come down to a petition, would you folks be willing to sign this? I think there was a Mr. Abrams is one name that comes to mind. He said, sounds like a good thing to me. He said, I don't have any problem with it. I mean, there's a fellow in Delano Park. And I did the same thing with other people and Sherwood just going through. I said, if it were to come, because my thought would be, let me get a petition. I will bring this back to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee. Here's names of everyone saying, we have no problem with you practicing football. I didn't go that far because I started calling them on the telephone. They said, well, we will never have another meeting. The best that you can do is come before the town council and make this type of presentation. So.
Yes, Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify the record and ask a couple of procedural questions. First of all, the council may wonder why this wasn't on the agenda. We had a miscommunication. I had spoken to a member of the board of the football group who indicated that they weren't going to be needing the fort, and that was the misunderstanding. That's why it's not on the agenda. Second, I'm a little bit confused as to what you just said about you brought this request to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Their minutes indicate the same thing that your June 30th letter did, and it wasn't this proposal at all. It was that you were looking to have your home football season beginning in September. So they have not, according to their minutes as I read them, they were reviewing the issue of the season primarily. Thanks. Then you did make an oral request for practice on a few days in August, and they denied that. And you know, one thing, if the council is inclined to support this, I think it's very important that we really tie down the dates that you're looking for, because you know, these minutes we didn't get them until late Friday. I didn't see them until late this afternoon. You know, we have other events at Fort Williams that may have already been scheduled, and you know, I'm just reluctant. You know, I'm just hearing a general time frame of dates that we really need to tie down, because we've promised facilities to other people already. We need to be absolutely sure that you know that, so you don't show up.
Let me retract. You're 100% correct. The original written request to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee was to use this area as our home field. Okay. I apologize if that was something that I should have brought up. The reason for this was because it's an ideal football field to my eyes as a football person. Right? The fact that we did have the moratorium on the field to use, the fact that at that point, at the time of the presentation to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, I had not been given a firm approval for the use of the softball field. So I was looking to just make it very simple, let us use that. Now, at that same meeting, we then amended what we requested, and we said, if you can't give us the field, please let us practice there. Because it had been, I guess, the day of that meeting, I had talked with Little League personnel, and they had said, okay, you can use you can use Lions Field. So that's, am I making that clear?
Yeah, but
okay.
I understand.
Made one request, then we changed it.
Excuse me, the minutes say, a motion was, these are draft minutes, haven't been reviewed by the board, but the secretary noted this here. A motion was then made that the football group's oral request made during the course of the commission meeting for permission to use the parade ground field for practice on, quote, in quotation marks, a few days in August, end of quotation marks, be denied. The motion was seconded. Commission members expressed the same concerns as set forth above. As they had with respect to the written request, the motion carried by unanimous vote. What are the few days in August, I think is what I'm looking for.
Okay. Well, a few days in August would be those days that you would allow us to practice. Okay?
Well said.
All right. We're halfway through August, or approaching a third of the way, and we're practicing three or four times a week, and I don't know. You know, if it were strictly my way, it would be double sessions, and it would be 7 days, and it would be 3 hours a session. I don't know whether they can, you know, they're getting there, but the kids aren't there yet, you know. And if I have to do it once a week, or twice a week, or three times a week, et cetera, you know, I don't know whether the camel's going to break, you know.
My point being, if the council is inclined to approve this, if there could be some flexibility in the motion so that it's clear that other events are already scheduled.
Okay, let me make the motion then, or just say, by all means, we will work around anything. I mean, we need space. I mean, at this time, we're doing 5:30 to 7:30 at Lions Field on Tuesdays and Thursdays. That's going around the Little League schedule. We're 8 to 10 Saturday mornings. That's around, hopefully, everybody else's schedule. If you say to us, you can do this, that, the other thing, but you can't do this, this, and this, we certainly won't, you know.
Are there other questions? Yes, Council Berry.
Mr. Chairman, is it appropriate to suspend the rules and insert another item in the agenda? We proceed that way?
I think that's up to the council.
Yeah.
Then I would move that we suspend the rule. Now, there's another problem here. I had nothing to do with you, Mr. Bell. No, it's just a typo, I think. Last meeting, I noticed we had item 29, and item 28 was taken after item 29, so I think it was just a quick reading here, where we started this week with, this month with item 29. I think we should have a 29A in there someplace to fix that up, that's all. Just so that when the minutes are approved from the previous meeting, that point is made clear. And then I would move to suspend the rules to consider taking up Mr. LaValle's situation.
Is there a second to that?
Second.
Councilor Reed. Discussion on, yes, Councilor Fritz.
I have real problems with considering this tonight, since we're just getting this letter, this proposal. We haven't had a chance to look at the Fort Williams Committee minutes. I just don't think it's appropriate to make a decision on it tonight. I mean, all the other scheduled things that are there, I mean, I think we'll make a bad decision if we make a decision tonight.
The motion is to suspend.
Good point. The motion is simply to suspend the rules and then to put forward a motion as to how it might be done. Councilor Watson.
I would suggest, I understand Councilor Fritz's concerns. However, it is August 10th. They practice Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays. If we suspend this for a couple more weeks, September 5th will be upon us, and these children will not have had a chance to practice in a regulation field. Understanding that we're dealing with ages 8 through 14, and Bob has already inspected the fields and said there's minimal damage that's occurred already in the past 2 weeks, I think it would behoove us to move forward and to allow these children to practice as long as the league understands that it has to be around the schedules that already is in place for Fort Williams. and I think that we need to allow Cape Elizabeth youth football to move forward as expeditiously as possible. That's my view.
Let me interject only. If I understand correctly, we're only discussing a motion to suspend the normal rules, and then we can get to the issue of what we want to recommend.
Right. I'd like to move that question.
Yes.
I'll second the motion to suspend the rules.
All right. Thank you.
Second.
I think it was, yeah, seconded.
But that's okay.
Let us, unless there's any further discussion, let us move the motion. And the motion is simply to suspend and bring this in so that we can discuss it.
That's right.
And perhaps do something or perhaps not. Okay. All those in favor? Those against? It was six. You voted against, Carol?
I voted for.
Oh, you voted for. All right. It was unanimous then. Thank you. Okay. Now, having done that, is there a motion or is there discussion? Yes. Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that the manager be instructed to work with Mr. LaValle to work out a schedule, if that workout be the word, a schedule for the young football players to use Fort Williams in at such times as it does not conflict with previously scheduled events at Fort Williams at that area. From now until September 5th, well, from now until September 6th. Isn't that what you need till the 6th?
Yeah, yeah. The 5th, they say we can.
The 5th.
Yeah, fine.
All right.
The 5th is our home game. I mean, that's.
Okay, so now until September,
September 4th will be fine.
Is there a second to that? Councilor Reed?
I'll second it to September 5th. Correct? September 5th?
To September 6th. I think they need the 5th for the game, is that right?
I just want to be clear. We've heard three dates in the last minute.
September, from my end, September 4th is fine. September 5th is a Saturday, 1 o'clock. We'll be across the field.
Oh, all right.
You're all invited to come watch your first football game and have a nice...
Until September 5th is my moment.
Okay. I'll second that, and then may I comment, please?
Yes, please do.
First of all, I think it's unfortunate that this wasn't handled the proper way. Second of all, I don't think that the youth of the town should suffer. Thirdly, last February, when you should have gone before the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, is my understanding you didn't realize there was this issue, which is now upon you.
That's right.
And is this the inaugural season of this?
Yes, it is.
All right. In light of the fact that it is the first year that there are new people involved in a new organization presenting a new idea, for the young kids of Cape Elizabeth, I suggest we give them a little latitude and approve this 1 month use of Fort Williams.
Other questions and comments? Yes, Councilor McGinney.
I'd like to know if there's anybody else present who'd like to address the council on this.
Well, we have other members of the football group here, if you'd like.
John Chapman's present.
Yeah, I'd like to ask, I think that's a fair comment, though, and I think to ask if there's someone from the Fort Williams Commission committee that would like to speak and or others, but I want to limit the discussion. This isn't on the agenda in the formal sense, so we'll try to keep it fairly brief. Yes, sir, who are you?
John Chapman.
Yes. I knew who you were, John.
Basically, I'm here to answer any questions. I think, set forth in the minutes fairly carefully what our concerns were. When this was presented to us by letter dated June 30th, it came before us at our meeting on July 16th. Basically, the proposal was for there to be, for the stadium field or parade ground field to be the home field for three teams. The two that you've heard from today, those being a middle school team, basically, and an elementary school age, and then a smaller group of kids, flag football. The proposal was for them to use that field as their home field throughout the season, and I don't recall the exact number of games. I believe one level it was something like, nine games, Paul, correct me if I'm wrong. The other was four, and then the flag football was some indeterminate number. Our concerns about that proposal were basically three. First, moving to that type of use of that surface would constitute, in our judgment, with the advice of Bob Malley, a fairly significant change and increase in the wear and tear on that field. Basically, it would move the situation from being one where there's really no care that needs to be given to that field other than, I think, once a year they fertilize it. We would have to move to a system of, as is done at the school fields, slice seeding each year and then a period of rest. And that would be over some period of time during the summer, during which time the field would obviously have to be off limits, both for recreational use, occasionally use by people, and also by any sports teams that might already have an entitlement or an expectation of that field. So that was the first concern. Number one, the wear and tear on the field, and really the what we thought was a dramatic change in the wear and tear on that field. The second concern was parking and traffic. We had no information before us concerning the traffic flow, concerning the parking demands. I believe the estimate that they gave us was something like 100 cars, but there was nothing definite at all. Third, with significant use requests, we usually expect that it be submitted, that the request be submitted to us by January, late January, for consideration in February. And the reasons for that are fairly obvious. We have to schedule Fort Williams. We have to have appropriate time to consider whether a particular use is in the best interest of Fort Williams. And for a whole variety of reasons, we have to, with significant use requests, we have to have a fair amount of lead time. I think the commission was, there's no question, it was unanimous, and it felt fairly strongly that given how little time we had been allowed to consider it, in other words, it was laid on us literally at the last minute, we felt very strongly that the request ought to be denied. The group also presented to us an oral request for permission to use the field on an indeterminate number of times, a few times, as they put it, between now and September, which, as I understand it, is the proposal that's now before you. Our concerns were basically the same as with respect to the larger request, although obviously on a slightly smaller schedule, a smaller scale. But also our concern was that we should not create an expectation on the part of these kids and on the part of the participants, an expectation that naturally arises when somebody is given a limited opportunity to use something, an expectation that it will be available on a larger scale later. And although that's not a spoken part of this, from what we could glean from their written request, they were pretty serious about wanting to use that field as their home field. In any event, so as not to create that type of expectation, thereby making it that much more difficult once the process is underway, we thought that it was appropriate that we recommend to the town council that it not approve this.
Questions for Mr. Chapman? Yes, Councilor Watson.
Mr. Chapman, do you envision, if you look at the current schedule between now and September 5th, if you will, you take out Thursday, August 20th for the circus that's going to be there. That's 10 days, 6 hours a week between now and September 5th. That's what we're looking at. If you take Tuesdays and Thursdays and Sundays, we're looking at 10 days minus the day for the circus. Do you envision that being a major issue in the utilization of that field? I mean, a significant impact greater than, let's say, T-ball that goes on in the spring
I really don't have an opinion on that. I can't speak to the scheduling issues. I don't know what might be scheduled. I suspect nothing is scheduled during weekday afternoons or Saturdays this time of year, but I don't know for sure. I'm not an expert on the wear and tear on that field, and no, I can't say any better than you can.
Okay.
How much wear that would cause.
All right.
Other questions, councilors? Okay. Yes, Councilor Reed.
I just have a comment for Mr. Chapman. When I vote to have this go forward, whether I'm on the prevailing side or not, I just want you to know that I'm doing it not in an effort to undermine the authority or the work that the Fort Williams Advisory Commission does. And having gone to your meetings, I know how serious the committee members are about the 90 acres that we know to be Fort Williams Park. However, I do think and I hope
that for my vote at least, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission members will understand that as a town councilor, my responsibility is the whole town, and in this case, 70 kids.
I certainly understand that. I suspect the commission does too.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Chapman, thank you very much. Is there anyone else that wishes to speak? Yes, Ms. Lovato.
Oh, okay.
I'm just speaking as a resident of this town for the past 35 years. And as a coach of that Little League team, that, you know, I went through this wonderful experience myself in 1965 when we won the state championship. And it's nice to see the exact same feelings amongst these kids that I had then. And Fort Williams is one of the nicest places in the world. It is such a wonderful natural asset for this community to have. And I've been very active in Little League since my son and daughter were of age. And the field that we're talking about, there are quite a few holes and whatnot. We've tried to help it for the T-ball and whatnot. But, you know, where Mr. LaValle has promised that they would, you know, fix whatever problem that would arise, I would think that, have somebody examine the field on September 5th, and if they need, you know, to do whatever needs to be done, it would be a shame not to let these kids, you know, learn, you know, the sport of football and, the idea of teamwork and, being proud of being part of this community. And, sports have been a great part of my life, and to deprive, 50, 60, 70 kids and 20 cheerleaders, just the opportunity to play on an even level with other communities that really go crazy over athletics. I think that it would be a shame to have the town council not approve, a 10-day period or a two-week period. And if it turns out that the field gets torn up or whatever, have them come fix it and then say, all right, forget it. You're never playing football here again. But, it's such a wonderful asset. Why not let it be used? And I would think that as a sidelight to this, we can repair some of the holes that really need to be fixed for the T-ball fields. So, it might, work out even better. Thank you.
Thank you. Other people to speak? Okay. Yes.
I just had another question of Mr. LaValle. Since this seems to be, I kind of lost track of how many leagues and how many things are being proposed, but since it seems to be a multi-town kind of league, what other towns have you approached for field space to use?
I have not. Well, okay. The only other facility that we have approached is the Southern Maine Technical College. We have met with John Dakin, who's the athletic director of Southern Maine Technical College. He takes over the field, and the state might be wrong, but I'm going to say August 22nd. Up until August 22nd, it is under the auspices of the South Portland Recreation Department. We have filled out a request and sent that to the South Portland Recreation Department for usage of the Southern Maine Technical College field. We have not heard from them. They are inundated with requests for that field, but that's the only other field that we have inquired about. Now, flag football started here, just to maybe bring you up to speed on things. Flag football started last year as part of the Recreation Department. Now, we used the lacrosse field. We had 63 players. Those were grades 1 through 8. We started our organization here there were people that said, can we get tackle football in here? We put together a group. We had a meeting the beginning of April. And that's when we started a tackle organization. Sue Weatherby has been extremely helpful to me in getting the flag football program done. I spoke with Keith Weatherby, and he said he could use the outfield of the softball field and this is all in preparation for our, for my getting a group together to have a tackle meeting. It was never mentioned to me about the moratorium on the usage of the fields until the 11th hour, and that's when we went to the Fort William Advisory Committee after we were told that we didn't have a field of practice. Now, also at that point, at the time of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee meeting, we did not have a firm, what's the right word? Firm schedule on the usage of that softball field. We since have, we put that in writing. Sue Weatherby said that's fine and discussed it with Keith. And so it was just the next day or so after that Fort Williams Advisory Committee that we did not have to make the grand proposal of give us a field. We had a field. Now it was just, now I'm coming to you as a place to practice. The rec department will be running flag football on their own field. Have I answered that fully for you?
Councilor Reed.
I just have one clarification. Councilor Fritz's comment just confused me. We're only talking about practice on
this
field. We're not talking games.
No, our games will be at the softball field.
That's what I heard earlier. I just wanted to make sure.
Are there other councilors with questions or comments? Councilor Goff.
Are we talking about having a fixed schedule that you're going to present for practices to Mr. McGovern? Would that be ideal for you? I mean, there's certain nights, and those practices wouldn't exceed 4 a week. Is that what we're talking about?
Okay, practices. At September 5th, we have a field. That's step one.
Mm-hmm. I'm talking about between now and September 5th.
Okay, between now and September 5th, I would like to be able to have the usage of Fort Williams Field to practice at the coach's discretions.
Well, that's my only issue, because I think what you need to do is for me to support this, and I will. But I think there has to, I'm more than happy to delegate any discretion the town has to the town manager, because I have every confidence in the town manager that he can handle this issue. But I think you should go into this thinking that you have to sit with the town manager, come up with a schedule. I don't think it's going to be more than 4 nights a week. There's the circus coming, there's other things coming, and it's a temporary measure. It's a shame for everybody that, you know, we've spent an hour on this that obviously isn't the most pressing issue in the town, but I understand very important for 70 children. But I think we can leave, in my view, we can leave this matter with the discretion of the town manager. I'm sure you and the town manager can work out a schedule that does not exceed 4 days a week, and for this very, very short period of time between now and September 5th, without any precedent being set that anybody's saying that the Fort is going to be the place for football in the future or anything else. All we're trying to do is get by right now to give kids an opportunity to have some realistic practice before the game, and for that reason I would support this very limited motion with the town council depending on the town manager to execute and look after the interest of the town.
And may I clarify, I understood Mr. Berry's motion to be that it was the manager who was going to coordinate not only with Mr. LaValle, but I assume with the Fort Committee and anybody else that's appropriate.
Yeah. I just
Mr.
Berry's motion was the manager to work with these folks, but the operative language was to use such times as it does not conflict with other uses.
Absolutely.
There was absolutely no limit put on it. It was simply at such times that it does not conflict. There was no limit of four. That was not part of the motion. It was just at the times that it doesn't conflict.
And that's my point, that I would like to see to satisfy all concerned. I really think if you're using the Fort between now and September 4th for up to 4 times a week with the discretion of the manager, that you should be able to work that out, and 4 times a week is plenty. Fine. And that should satisfy people's concerns. Yep. About some type of overuse, and we all know what we're dealing with then. We have the parameters set, and I have every confidence the town manager can then protect the interest of the town and also the interest of the 70 children who obviously need a place to play.
Wonderful.
Councilor Reed.
On that motion that I seconded, we didn't have a restriction of four nights or 4 hours or four anything.
No.
And I would just, I personally don't support that if they need 4.5 hours or 4 hours and 15 minutes.
If he gives us four days and we're going to practice 2 hours a session, which I think is fine, that's fine with us.
So can that be understood without being part of the motion? Yeah. Since Michael's discretion.
Oh, I'm going to do it.
Councilor Fritz, excuse me.
I'd just like to express that I don't favor this motion. I think that a request has not been timely by this league, either to the Fort Williams Committee or to this council. I think that we've had requests for fields, and we're in the process of building fields which aren't available for the existing sports that we have. And that's still not enough, according to what I understand our needs are. So to bring in another sport to use our fields, to have the wear and tear on them, I think doesn't make any sense to me. I'm very concerned about going against the Fort Williams Committee's unanimous report. I think that they thought it through very carefully, and I agree with them. The number of things that Mr. Chapman mentioned as their concerns, particularly the increase and the change in the wear and the tear, the traffic, that the request should have been earlier, and I am concerned very much about the creating an expectation that the town of Cape Elizabeth will provide a field in the future, both for play or for practice. And I don't think there was nearly enough exploring of other towns' facilities, at least exploring them, whether or not they had adequate facilities or not. So I will not be supporting this.
Other comments? Councilor Watson.
I would just suggest that after all this discussion, we move this to a vote. I think that we need to move on.
All right. Debbie, you want to take a shot at quickly and succinctly reiterating what it is that we're voting on, please?
I'll certainly try. The way I understand the motion is the manager is instructed to work with Mr. LaValle to work out a practice schedule for youth football for the use of the parade ground at Fort Williams Park from now until September 5th, with the understanding that already scheduled events shall have precedence.
Okay, we're ready for the motion. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Against. Okay, it's 6-1 in favor. We move on, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your consideration. Yep. Mr. McGovern will be speaking with you.
Okay, we're now ready to, I think, return. Are there any other citizens' discussion items that people would like to bring up that are not already on the agenda? Hearing and seeing none, we'll move on to something else. Councilor reports and correspondence. Yes, Councilor Berry.
I am reporting back on the item that we mentioned last meeting on the County Budget Advisory Committee. I would like to thank Councilor Watson for appearing at the caucus in South Portland, at which Chris Bowering from the South Portland Council was unanimously confirmed. We had two people from Newtown of Fry Island, Maine.
Oh, really?
And Councilor Watson and myself met with Councilor Bowering and our commissioner from our district, who is Peter Feeney. And Chris Bowering was elected and has attended the meeting.
Good, thank you.
And thank you again, Councilor Watson, for supporting us.
Other reports and correspondence. Councilor Reed.
Sorry, I didn't get this in before the football boosters left, but I just would like the public to be reminded that September is coming, and with that, we will be taking applications for the bottle shed or the returnable bottle shed at the transfer site, and I would urge anyone who's interested in completing an application for the upcoming cycle to contact the town manager's secretary, Mrs. Ray, at 799-5251. Thank you, and there will be an upcoming article in the Cape Courier.
Thank you. Councilor Groff.
I'm sure we'll hear more about it later, but from the manager, but I would just like to thank all the employees of Cape Elizabeth for making the beach-to-beacon run so successful. It was an absolutely fabulous day in this town. It made me proud to live here. We had the, my wife and I and my children had the state of Maine, the woman from the state of Maine who was the fastest in the state of Maine from Harpswell, she and her husband stayed with us. It was just a great weekend, and I think, and I certainly hope all the employees of this town feel good about themselves because they just did a fabulous job.
Thank you. Other reports, Councilor McGinnis.
I'd like to follow that up. I'd like to thank the people who are out there. I ran the race, not very well, but I ran the race. And just the support along the route. By the time I went by, probably the race was over. they were still cheering the people I was with on. I mean, constantly applauding and just cheering us all on. And I was also very proud to be part of the race and to see the support that people really came out. And it was very gratifying.
Well, I'd like to add a comment to that because I was intending to in a moment or two. Councilor McGinty is excessively modest. He went by not with the first five, but there were then several groups, and he was with the next group and was very credible. So I think you deserve the recognition.
Thank you. I just get those 2,800 people out of my way next time.
Okay, all set on, oh yes, Councilor Reed.
Well, just a piece of information, anecdotal though it may be, for the people who don't get to read all of Town Manager McGovern's correspondence. I think it's noteworthy to state that one out of every 40 residents in this town participated and finished. So we're not counting the ones who paid the $18 for the t-shirt and didn't participate, or people who couldn't finish the race for one reason or another, but of those who finished, there were 1 in 40 ratio. So in terms of the support of the community, they were supporting the event, the cause, and also the spirit of the race. So I'd just like to say thanks to everybody in Cape Elizabeth, because I'm outside of Cape Elizabeth working very often, and I've seen people this week who were still wearing their t-shirts because they were so proud of their accomplishment, and they weren't from Cape. So I just think overall it was very well done.
Good, thank you. Any other reports, correspondence? Manager McGovern.
I wanted to give actually a little longer report than I usually do, and there's been a lot of attention on the road race, but it got me to thinking, you know, what else has been going on since July 1, and that I think, you know, some of that's been forgotten. I wanted to go over some of those things as well. This past, since July 1, which was the start of our fiscal year, we've just constructed a sidewalk at Kettle Cove that's nearing completion. There is a gorgeous new cliff walk at Fort Williams Park. I don't know if anyone's been out to see it yet, but it's been under construction. It is absolutely beautiful. And there'll be a dedication ceremony probably sometime in September for it. But if anyone has a chance to get out there, it's just unbelievable. The famous ball fields at Fort Williams Park and Lions Field, the contractor has completed his work, other than some watering and some minor adjustments, so those are now completed. There's a new sidewalk on Scott Dyer Road that was put in by the contractor for the assisted living center. We've worked with some residents with issues involving that sidewalk. This past week, all of Brentwood, Lower Brentwood was paved. We also paved Trundy Road, Hannaford Cove Road, Todd Road, part of Mitchell Road, Julianne Lane. There was a major sewer project that was just completed, sewer repair project on Elmwood, Maplewood, and Cottage Farms Road. We hosted the Portland Symphony Orchestra with about 5,000 attendees. There was a 6,000 attendee change of command ceremony for the Coast Guard at Fort Williams Park. We had 1,000 people at the fort a couple of days ago when the Coast Guard Bark Eagle came in. The reservations at the picnic shelter and the Spurwink Church were at a peak capacity during the month of July. The police department hired a new dispatcher. Greg Tinsman is coming back after not working with us in a full-time capacity for many years. Eric Wellman is going back to school. The director of public works hired a new tree warden, Thomas Nee, who Bob's been working with training to replace Rick Churchill, who retired. Jane Beckwith retired this past month after 28 years of service at the Thomas Murray Library and was honored by her co-workers at a reception that the chairman and one other counselor also attended. We had an employee recognition event at the Pomputa Club with a very excellent motivational speaker. The facilities manager, Ernie McMain, served in the de facto role this past month as general contractor for the now nearly completed renovation of the upstairs of the 30s building of the middle school. He also worked to remove all the asbestos, which has been done over at the Levitt property. And we've worked, as you'll see later on the agenda this evening, with the architect for renovations of the basement to the middle school. A number of renovations were completed in the library, including all new shelving on the children's side, and there was a revamped adult side. We unveiled a new town webpage that it's now regularly updated. We had meeting with the city of South Portland on the boundary perambulation between South Portland and Cape Elizabeth, and there'll be a report for the council next month on that. There were some meetings with the state on the town center sidewalk and drainage project, and that'll be coming to the town council next month as well. On the financial side, we completed, Deborah mainly completed the tax lien process for the year, and that resulted in probably the record low amount of past due taxes in the modern era as a result of the citizen paying their taxes and good collection practices. We also had our highest month ever for excise tax collection during the month of July, keeping that office very busy. For July only, we had the very best month at the Museum of Portland Headlight and at the gift shop both. We nearly completed the annual audit for the year. Most of the work is done. There's just a little bit more work to be done on. A number of other projects were worked on that's going to be discussed later in the agenda, including the cemetery, some financing, the ordinance committee working on the addressing ordinance. The police department conducted a neighborhood forum on an issue involving skateboards, which I understand was a very interesting meeting. We began a review of how the cost for private fire hydrants are being charged, an issue that's arisen. The annual tax commitment was completed by the assessor. The codes office worked on a number of controversial issues. We worked on a very controversial proposal to a gentleman wants to renovate the lighthouse at Two Lights, and fortunately Earl Shuttleworth is reviewing those plans, and a number of citizens have called us with very strong concerns. The planning staff completed a review of the zoning ordinance and proposed a whole series of technical amendments that have gone to the planning board. And you know, that's just a few things that have gone on. One interesting thing this past week is we had an individual come in the office, rather unexpectedly, a woman, and she gave Barbara Ray a $20 bill. And this was to repay a general assistance grant that a member of her family had gotten for a prescription 4 to 5 years ago. And you know, it was just one of, you know, I think just a very nice thing that someone came in and repaid something like that, but just indicative of the breadth of things that happened. You know, and as was mentioned, in addition to all this, we had a road race that, you know, was a tremendous effort on the part of really the entire community. Every single department was involved in one way or the other, community services, helping organize the registration, the school buses, helping with transportation running, the public works, getting the park ready, helping out in so many different ways, the police department, the rescue, the fire police unit, even the library with different issues that arose, you know, the town office with all the different questions. And, you know, I think when I look at all that they did in the road race and so public and all the praise, I really think that, you know, everything else that was done, you know, was done just as well and just as professionally. And, you know, I want to say really how proud I am of everyone that, you know, that they accomplished all this. And, you know, I wouldn't say we're quite that busy every month, but but I think it is representative of the work that they do throughout the year. So I really want to join Councilor Groff and the council in thanking the employees, not only in the road race, but everything else that's being accomplished.
Good. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Moving on to the minutes of the previous meeting, would anyone care to make a motion? Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, before we do, I guess it's just a type I mentioned before. Item 29, I think, was on the last agenda. And we took item 28 first, item 29 first, and then 28. And so 28 showed on the minutes as the last one, but we had already dealt with 29. And I noticed that number item 29 is the first one on this week's list. So probably some, call it 29A or something.
So make tonight's 29A?
Yeah, all right.
Is that fine with everyone?
Can you do that easily?
I think we just did, but I'm not sure.
The town clerk will have these minutes reflect a proper numbering system.
Okay, a motion? Any changes to the minutes?
I move that they be accepted.
Thank you very much. It's moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Watson, thank you. Any further discussion? Hearing none, let us vote. All in favor? Any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you. Moving to item number 29A, consider approval of renovation plans for the basement of the middle school. Mike, would you care to address that for us, please?
Yes. As I mentioned, one of the projects being worked on is the renovation of the middle school. A couple months ago, you approved the plans for the second floor of the middle school, and that project is now nearly done, or it will be done in time for school to begin and for the teachers to move in. The other good news, one of the town council goals this year was to find new space for community services, and the school board worked with Sue Weatherby and the rest of the staff at community services to come up with a plan to renovate the basement of the middle school. It was discussed during your budget process. There was a financing plan for it, with community services going to be paying back the money over a period of time, over the next 5 years. And they have been working with an architect, which, you know, in recent history, that wasn't always the case. The architect prepared plans, and they are ready and raring to go to work on it this fall. And Ernie and Sue are here to ask any specific questions you have, and they hope to get your approval of the plan so that we can then move on and start the bidding process.
What's the pleasure of the council?
Any questions?
Councilor Berry, yes. Fine. Start with questions.
Oh, I know that we had three classrooms here, and then it's a multi-purpose room. What's the concept for the multi-purpose room? What's that going to be used for? I'm just wondering, could that be a classroom sometime, or is there some other use?
Thanks for coming, Sue.
Yeah, thanks.
You've got the podium.
The multi-purpose room would be used for...
Excuse me, this is Sue Weatherby, for anybody who possibly doesn't know. Okay, go ahead.
The multi-purpose room would be used as gymnasium space. It could be used for snack for the extended day rooms. We will be getting portable tables and chairs that can be moved in and out so that we can have an open play space for them at times when the gymnasiums and the cafeteria may not be available for that open space. We also plan to use it during the school day to run some of our daytime programming. Could be used for senior citizens. We're hoping to have a small kitchen, i.e. sink, stove, or something there so that we could have some senior citizen functions there as well during the school day. As you probably know, our senior citizen organization has grown to the point where we have, in some respects, outgrown the use of the 1226 Shore Road Community Center for many functions. Mm. We do guest speakers and small catered lunches there now, but the capacity really for one room is about 32 people.
Yeah.
It's very tight. So this would probably accommodate up to 50 people for a luncheon. So it will give us that flexibility during the school day.
But the classrooms that are designed here, are those for high school students?
No, those would be our extended day rooms. We run the extended daycare program during off kindergarten hours during the day so that children attending morning kindergarten may need afternoon daycare, and those attending afternoon kindergarten would need morning daycare. After the school day, those spaces would be also utilized with all of the children coming in first through sixth grade that we would be accommodating.
The multi-purpose room, could that be set up for a classroom also, if necessary?
It could be, yes.
Can you hear through the walls there as designed?
I'm not sure what the soundproof construction will allow, but...
It's going to be soundproof? That's fine. So you couldn't hear from one of the next.
Just to clarify, what we're using now as our daycare spaces, we're housed at the high school. We're using two kindergarten rooms.
Yeah.
And a third kindergarten room is our office space. Because of the increase in the number of sections of kindergarten for this year, we actually are losing one of those kindergarten spaces for a morning kindergarten session. So it will be a sharing proposition until we're able to move over there. So things will be a little tight. In the afternoon, presently, we use our two extended day rooms. We use a special ed space on the second floor. We utilize the high school cafeteria, the gymnasium when it's available. So we will be using some outreach in other areas of Pond Cove and Middle School after the school day to accommodate the numbers.
Thank you.
Other questions? Councilor Fritz.
It was my understanding when we had the workshops on this, that this section would be renovated as though it were classroom space, mm-hmm. not specially designed for community services or the extended daycare, because this is, I mean, even in the year that we've been discussing the school needs report, it was thought that the second floor of the building was not going to be needed for classrooms, but then by the time we got further into the discussions, it was going to be needed. So
actually,
essentially, there's no extra rooms.
Essentially, with community services using it as it stands, there's no extra room. But at some point where kindergarten was made a full-day school, then those extended day rooms would not be needed for extended daycare during the day, in which case they could be used for classroom spaces.
Was it in the high school?
Excuse me?
In the high school?
No, I'm talking about our new space.
Oh.
Right. So they could be converted to classrooms.
Councilor Reed?
Yes. So does this plan meet your needs, program and staff needs, in the next 5 years?
If we're able to branch out and use other areas within the school complex after the school day, it could meet our needs. As it stands alone, it definitely doesn't even give us the square footage that we are presently utilizing at the high school. And in order to accommodate the numbers of children we have, right now we're full for after-school daycare in the fall. And we are only allowed to take so many children according to our square footage. And right now, we need to use other areas in the school to allow for the numbers that we're presently accepting.
Has there been any suggestion that if this renovation project were complete, you would be restricted in any way from using the other parts of the buildings that you need for the rest of your program?
We haven't had a discussion about that yet.
Would
but I assume
that
since community services schedules the building after the school day, when it's not needed for, you know, a school activity, I would say that we would have access to those spaces in the same manner we do for community programs.
But this would be a big help?
Oh, definitely.
Thank
you. Other questions? Would anyone care to make a motion?
She's a great person with that computer. I think that all those school buses fly.
Hearing no more questions, the chair awaits a motion of some. Oh yes, Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the town council approve the renovation plans of the basement of the middle school, as stated.
Thank you. Is there a second, Councilor Groff?
There is.
All right. Thank you very much. Is there further discussion? Here. Oh yes, Councilor Fritz.
I just really have concerns about renovating this to fit just community services and extended daycare as though those programs were going to stay in those spaces. I think that the priority for the space is classroom for regular day school at the middle school.
Education.
And I think it's fine for them to use a space that would be finished this year or next year and continuing for several years as long as that space was not used for regular classrooms. But I don't think there should be an expectation that they would stay in that space. I think they have to be flexible to move to where it isn't needed for regular classroom space.
Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, as a former school board member, I might remind Councilor Fritz that it's not the town council's purview to oversee the activities of community services. It is our purview to provide the space for them to operate currently as requested.
That's what we're discussing, is the space for them to operate.
Right. Okay, moving on. Other questions, discussion? Councilor McGinney.
It's always been my understanding over the years that if the classroom space was needed, the classroom space was going to go to the school.
That's right.
And, you know, we're not at that point, obviously, but that would be, I mean, we've always discussed that, as I recall. That's always been the focus of our discussion. Obviously, educating the kids comes first, as much as a great service they provide, you know, community service.
Councilor Goff.
And I'm very, I believe this plan is contingent, I mean, is consistent with that rationale, and that's why I support this plan.
Okay, any further discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I guess maybe I should ask if this space was needed for, say, a third classroom. I didn't seem to get my second packet that came with the plans in it, so I'm not sure what the plan says, whether it's for two regular-sized classrooms and one kind of augmented space that has a kitchen in. Is that right? I mean...
Excuse me, Sue, come on up, and we'll just put this question to bed, please.
Yep. Just keep mine. I have artisan.
To answer your question, Carol, there are three rooms, a multi-purpose space and the community services office space. So there's actually a total of five spaces in that area. Because of supporting walls and so forth, some of the spaces had to be designed so that we did not interrupt any of those supporting walls. So some of the spaces probably are too small to meet the specification for a classroom. Is that correct, Ernie?
In order for them to qualify as a classroom, you have to have 30 square feet per student. They are fairly small rooms, so you would have a pretty small number in terms of the amount of children you could have in those rooms. Also, because it's a daycare, we get into a set of different building standards that don't apply to daycare that do apply to classrooms. So we would have to make some, although minor changes, we would have to make some exterior changes to the building in order for it to be classrooms. That's my understanding. Basically, it's a window issue in the classrooms that don't apply to daycare but do apply to regular classrooms.
Is it costing more to renovate it based on daycare standards rather than classroom standards?
I think it's costing less to do the daycare improvements.
And something would have to be done to it in order to make it classroom space,
right,
if we needed it.
That's correct, exactly. That's my understanding.
So that would be an extra expense?
It would be an extra expense. I don't think it would be that significant, but it would be an extra expense. And one of the reasons that I understand we didn't get into that now is because we're not proposing, nor do we want to propose any exterior changes to this building design. If we needed to renovate these or change these to classrooms, then we would have to come back and make some minor changes to the exterior of the building.
Any other questions, comments? We're ready to move the vote. Okay, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Any against? Okay, 6-1 in favor. Thank you very much. We'll now move on. And Sue and Ernie, thank you very much for coming in and answering those questions. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Moving to item 30, consider approval of the warrant for the November municipal special referendum election relating to the swimming pool and the Portland Water District trustee election to be on the same ballot on November 3rd. Debbie, would you like to comment on that, please?
Yes, I would. Thank you very much. If the council recalls, in July, there was a public hearing regarding the renovations to the pool based on the pool study committee's recommendations. Part of the order that the town council approved was I was asked to work with the town attorney to develop a ballot question. In your packet, actually at your seat this evening, there is a recommended warrant to call for a special municipal referendum election and Portland Water District trustee election to be held on Tuesday, November 3rd, which certainly would coincide with the state election. If I can take just a moment to read the ballot question. The first thing would be voting for one member of the Portland Water District trustees to serve a five-year term. The second would be pursuant to Title 38, MRSA Section 25285B, this ballot must be accompanied by the recommendations of the Town Council and School Board. The Town Council and School Board both recommend a yes vote to the following question. Shall the town renovate and expand the swimming pool facilities at the Cape Elizabeth High School to provide for, among other things, a new pool entrance area, spectator seating, and pool basin, renovation to locker rooms, and repairs to the locker room, all at an estimated project cost of $2.2 million? Again, the election will be held on Tuesday, November 3rd. Polls open at 7 a.m. and close at 8 p.m. I would recommend that the council approve the warrant. Also with that, please note that the school board last Thursday, I believe it was, they did recommend a yes vote on this pool renovation, and it is anticipated that the council would do the same this evening. The state law requires that the council and school board recommendation be on the ballot. I talked to Mike Hill, our town attorney, about another public hearing. Although the state law does not require it, his conservative recommendation is that, assuming that the council approve this warrant, which would in essence be approving the ballot question, that another public hearing be held. There's nothing for anyone to vote on, it's just really a public session so that the public can come and comment on the ballot question that will be on November 3rd. If the council so chooses to hold another public hearing, you may want to consider your October meeting, which would be Wednesday, October 14th, which would be a little bit closer to the November 3rd election.
Okay, let's take those as two issues. First is the discussion comment or a recommendation in the form of the warrant. Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the warrant for the November Municipal Special Referendum election relating to the swimming pool and the Portland Water District Trustee election on the same ballot, November 3rd, 1998.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second the motion, but I have a question.
Yes, seconded and a question. Go ahead.
I second the motion, yeah. Yep. As written here, it says repairs to the pool room. I believe as read, it said repairs to the locker room. Is pool room intended to be the word?
Well,
where
I can,
are you?
Next to last word on the
Proposed ballot.
Proposed ballot.
Or the warrant.
The renovations to the locker rooms and repairs to the pool room, right?
That I will double. That's what came in from the town attorney. I have their facts, but.
All right. Well, as you just read it, you said locker room, but it's intended to be
into the pool room. Yes.
Yeah. And when it says among other things, I'd like some clarification about as to what other things are.
Would the manager like to speak to that? I just prepared the ballot, Councilor.
It's okay.
They want to fix my car, and you know, that's another thing.
Yeah. Among other things, is the entire plan that was presented to the town council from the pool committee. Everything from, you know, as you mentioned, repairs to locker rooms to repairs to the systems to the boilers. You know, trying to get it onto a separate boiler so it can be separately kept track of. There's a very small Whirlpool spa that's involved in it. It's intended to bring in the entire scope of the project that builds up to the amount that you are considering this evening and that
don't
you reviewed with the committee.
Don't have a definite plan
We're at the preliminary design concept. We're currently negotiating a contract with the architects for final design, but that has not as of yet been done. The contract has not as of yet been signed.
You might mention, Mike, though, that we did hire professionals to do the estimates for all the work pieces, and we're reasonably comfortable that those projections are correct.
I don't need to. You just did.
Thank you. Yes, Councilor Fritz.
Yeah, I would like to see the wording on this ballot question more accurately reflect what the project is. I would like to move an amendment that would, after spectator seating, there'd be a comma, and then weight room and therapeutic whirlpool, semicolon. And then cross out and pool basin, and insert a complete renovation of the pool structure and related mechanical systems. I'd also like to more fully say what the project is, that it's a $2.2 million project, plus what the bond interest would be and what the total estimated cost would be. And I think it's important to include that it would be partially financed by revenue from user fees.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Groff?
We have a recurring discussion about things like this, that when we pay
the town to hire our attorney, and our attorney then drafts something for our consideration, to then, in the middle of the council meeting, to take that and ad hoc and change it, I feel is bad government. And for that reason, I would, one of two things. I mean, I would either say you don't like it and you send it back to the attorney, the town's attorney, for review, or we pass it the way the town attorney has drafted it. I think it's a recipe for disaster to do ad hoc changes when we're talking about a ballot question. Because for every consequence, there's an unintended consequence, and that's why we pay our counselor, our town attorney, to review things like this, and I just don't think it's a good policy way of moving. And so for that reason, I will not second your amendment, and I hope we either up or down what the town attorney has recommended.
Councilor Reed?
As a maker of the motion, I just want you to know I would not accept that. If that could end the discussion, that would make me happy.
I think that's the language.
Councilor Barry?
I think that the language is unclear. I agree with some of Councilor Fritz's thoughts here, and I would have greatest respect for Mike Hill, our attorney, of course, but I think that the people of the town can also read, and I would feel more comfortable if $2.2 million as an expenditure proposed were more specifically laid out as to exactly what's going to be done.
Well, then let me suggest that we do this. We have a motion on the table, which is to essentially take this as it is presented. Let us move on that, and if that passes, we move on to whatever the next item is. If it fails, we will then come back and we will then discuss how we may want to handle, amend, or otherwise change, or whatever we want to do with this. Is that satisfactory to everyone?
I think you need to deal with amendments before you deal with motions.
Well, the mover of the motion did not want to accept that amendment.
I don't think that's of concern.
Well,
I can make an amendment to a motion. She doesn't have to agree with it.
She was the mover of the motion. I believe she does. Is that not correct,
No.
Mike?
You have to deal with the amendment first.
Yeah.
Only if it was seconded.
And then,
all right, I'll second the amendment for discussion.
Any counselor who wishes to offer an amendment is entitled to offer an amendment. Any other counselor, is as long as it's germane, it can be seconded. If you, as the chairman or any counselor, wanted to cut off any amendment making, you'd have to move the question, and there'd have to be a vote on that issue.
Okay, well, before you go away, then, let me make sure that we properly handle this. Then there is a motion on the table, moved by Councilor Reed and seconded by Councilor Barry. And now we're suggesting that Councilor Fritz has proposed an amendment, which has not yet been seconded, which may be, and if it is, then you're suggesting we would handle that in that order?
That's correct. Until the question is moved, any councilor can make a question, can move an amendment, and as long as that amendment is seconded and it's germane, then that should be considered.
I'll second it for purpose of discussion.
Could I ask that I have no idea what the amendment was? It went for a period of time and about, and there wasn't any language, it just was ideas, and...
No, I had specific language. Excuse me
just a second. Let's get back. Now, we have a second. Mm-hmm. Your amendment, now you're being asked to clarify, and if you would just make it as specific as possible, and then Debbie can read it back to you after she gets it down, please.
Mm-hmm. After spectator seating, comma, add weight room and therapeutic whirlpool, semicolon.
Wait a minute, weight room.
Weight room and therapeutic whirlpool.
Okay.
Semicolon. Cross out and pool basin.
Yep.
Insert a complete renovation of the pool structure and related mechanical systems. This is precisely, although in a little different order, because I thought it was easiest to make the motion that way, the wording of the pool committee's unanimous support and recommendation to the council. They said they supported, or they urged the council to adopt option D, that it entails the complete renovation of the pool structure and related mechanical systems, the renovation of the locker rooms, and the addition of a new lobby, weight room, therapeutic whirlpool, and spectator seating. Now, I think that very clearly explains what the project is. I think if you look at just the wording that's here that was proposed originally, if you look back at the report of the pool study committee, you would, other than having the $2.2 million figure to look at, you might be confused as to whether we're talking about option C or D. And I think it's very important that when we put something on a ballot, that it is very clear for the public to vote on. And I'm sorry, but I don't think lawyers often deal with clear language. And I've been dealing with the League of Women Voters for 27 years, attempting to make voting user-friendly. And I think this is very important to be clear so people know exactly what they're voting for.
Okay, Debbie, you have the amendment?
I believe I do.
Okay. We're now discussing the amendment. Councilor Watson.
I'm a little confused, but what I'd like to see is, can we just vote this language, the amendment language, or should we take Joe's suggestion, which is if we don't like this language, send it back to the attorney with our suggestion that we want it more specific, and then vote on it?
We have the capability to do either, and right now, I believe.
Okay.
I would rather see us send it back. I agree with Joe that if we're going to have the language changed, at least let's have our attorney do it. Send the suggestion to him. If he feels it's fine, whatever. But I'd rather see it go back without us trying to change it here.
Yeah.
If that were the case, then we would vote against this amendment, and then we would vote against the primary motion, and with the caveat that it be sent back.
Yeah.
Mike, you had something to say?
Yeah, just if this does go back to the town attorney, some of the language that Councilor Fritz is proposing was in fact in the pool committee report, i.e. a complete renovation of the pool structure. However, when you actually look at their plan, that is not, they're not completely renovating the entire pool structure. You know, the pool structure can be defined as that whole building that the pool is in. And I think the attempt that Michael Hill made was to make it clearer and not to promise things to be done that really aren't being done, because, you know, I know there's a lot of controversy when the middle school plan was proposed, in that that plan did not provide for the complete renovation. It didn't do the basement of the middle school, it didn't do the second floor. So even though the pool committee said that, they didn't do it with eyes toward a ballot question. I think the town attorney has done a much more careful crafting of a ballot question to truly reflect the principles and the thrust of what's being done, and not to have erroneous information on the ballot question. So I you know, the council can send it back, but that language in particular is language that, you know, I will, you know, the town attorney is not as familiar with the project as we are, but you know, I will work with him to advise him that he ought to really read what they're doing, because I don't think that's what the pool committee truly proposed, even though that was the language they used.
If, I mean, I can understand what you're saying about the way the pool basin is, the terminology of that. What is the reason for leaving out the weight room and the therapeutic whirlpool?
There's no reason for leaving out the weight room, and there's no reason for leaving out the therapeutic whirlpool.
The other
However, you know, if, for example, with the weight room, if someone in the private sector, you know, ended up doing a major health club facility, you know, the town might want to make a business decision later on that you don't actually want that space used for a weight room for a health club, which is what that proposal had. You know, that could very likely happen. Similarly, if we ran into budget problems with the pool, you know, the council's going to say, no way you're going above $2.2 million. That's what the public authorized, that's it. The more specificity you had in the vote as to all of the things you're going to accomplish, the more you're setting yourself up for a problem in that the citizens are going to say, this is what I voted on, you didn't do it. So, you know, I think the town attorney has a real nice balance between specificity as well as, you know, generalness to try to be sure that, you know, whatever does happen is in keeping with what the citizens actually voted.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'd move to vote on the amendment.
Very good, I agree with that. Let me reiterate, or ask Debbie to reiterate the amendment, please.
Including the amendment, the ballot question would read, shall the town renovate and expand the swimming pool facilities at the Cape Elizabeth High School to provide for, among other things, a new pool entrance area, spectator seating, weight room and therapeutic whirlpool, renovations to the locker rooms, and a complete renovation of the pool structure and related mechanical systems.
All at an estimated project cost?
I'm sorry. All at an estimated project cost of $2.2 million.
Okay. I think it's been moved. We'll simply move to the motion. All those who are in favor of the motion, please raise your hand and so designate. This is the amendment. One. Those who are against. Okay, 6-1. All right, now that takes care of the amendment. Now we're back on the primary motion.
Mr. Chairman, I'd move a vote on the primary motion.
Very good. Let me reiterate, or ask to be reiterated, the primary motion is, read that again so everyone's clear.
Okay.
Please.
It is approving the warrant as at your seat this evening. That's voting for one member of the Portland Water District Trustees to serve a 5-year term. I don't want to forget that.
Yep.
The ballot question, shall the town renovate and expand the swimming pool facilities at the Cape Elizabeth High School to provide for, among other things, a new pool entrance area, spectator seating and pool basin, renovations to locker rooms, and repairs to the pool room, all at an estimated project cost of $2.2 million.
Is everyone clear on the motion? Councilor Reed.
Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Sure. Absolutely. Everyone prepared for the vote? Now this is on the... Yes, Councilor Berry?
With the among other things, a long time before there was a town council, there were selectmen in this town. And one item on the warrant at what time, one year, was to extend a particular sidewalk, a distance of 180 feet, more or less. One of the citizens rose at the town meeting, I believe it was Alonzo Murray, and he said, what does that more or less mean? And it was explained that they weren't going to measure it exactly. And he said, well, if you put a barrel of cider down beside a drinking man and you tell him he can take one pint more or less, he'll probably take more. And I, for that reason, I object to the language of among other things as being similarly not specific enough. However, I'm not going to let that hold back the swimming pool, and we're going to have to just trust in the contractors and the architects to do what was voted by the committee and by the council to do.
Okay, thank you.
I don't like that among other things language because it's not specific enough to spend $2.2 million, which is a lot.
Good point. We're now going to vote on the motion by means of a roll call. And let me just reiterate it, a yes vote means we pass the motion, a nay vote is a turn it down. Okay.
May I just comment a little bit?
Yes.
I mean, I agree with Councilor Berry that I really have trouble with the wording because I really don't think it's clear. And, you know, I hope it's not an attempt to not be clear so that people will not vote against it in
right.
some way. I mean, I hope that is not the case because I think this is a very good project. And so I am going to vote for the wording, but I hope it isn't to be unclear on purpose.
Roll call vote. Go ahead.
Councilor Berry.
Yes, for the motion.
Councilor Fritz.
Yes.
Councilor Groff.
Yes.
Councilor McGinty.
Yes.
Councilor Reed.
Yes.
Councilor Watson.
Reluctantly, yes. I don't like the language.
Chairman Beyer?
Yes.
Motion carries, 7 yeas.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on, perhaps appropriately so, to the Riverside Cemetery.
I'm dying.
Under 31.
I'm signing up soon. I'm going to be in that first group of 400.
Consider an award of a bid to expand Riverside Cemetery. Debbie, are you going to speak to this, Ms. Mike?
I will attempt to, sir.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. It is my pleasure to present this item this evening as this project has been fast approaching for the last 5 years. Since the master plan was developed in 1993, we knew at some point around this time that we would be getting to this project. Again, the first step was the master plan. The master plan told us how much land we had and what the build-out was at the site in back of the Spurwink Church. This package before you has been created after many hours of review and analysis, while keeping in mind the needs of the community, the character of the present site, and fiscal responsibility. And I guess I will confess to the council this evening, I am making an assumption. I'm making an assumption that the council deems this service to the community, that they want to continue this need and this service to the community. We have kept the council abreast of what's been going on as we've been going through the planning board, the zoning board, and so forth, and so far there has not been any objections. So that is my assumption regarding this. Our analysis now tells us that to expand the Riverside Cemetery needs to be done now. Over the past 40 years, we have had some 2,500 plus lots at the cemetery. We are down to about 120. It is my educated guess by June 30th of next year, we will have 50. So this is the time. As far as the funding, we did open bids at the end of July. Gorham Sand and Gravel was the low bidder. We did bid this as a winter project, hoping that the cost would be somewhat less than if they went into the spring and summer season. Unfortunately, that did not happen as far as the cost being, it's a little bit higher than what we had estimated. Let me leave it at that. As far as the scope of the project, it prepares the roads and the water utility for the entire expansion. We are estimating somewhere between 1,600 and 1,800 lots that we will be creating. It's going to clear trees and ledge, moving and shaping the land for the cemetery. We are looking, because of economies of scale, to grub in all the roads for the entire build-out of the cemetery. However, the selling of the lots will be by phasing, which we have done in other areas of the cemetery, and that has served us very well. We are finding that the cost is really in the hauling in of the loam and the gravel. We feel that the project would be compromised if less loam and gravel was used for the project. We did meet following the bid with Gorham Sand and Gravel. We did reduce a little bit some value engineering of the project, some $8,000, I think it was. As far as the budget, we are looking, including contingency, at $284,980. We do have to put in some added monies for mapping, lot markers, and signage. So we're talking a $300,000 project. When we look at our capital improvement fund for the cemetery, we have $160,000. And I may note that several years ago, what we did was we started to create a cemetery expansion fund and a perpetual care fund. So currently, the monies that come in for a full-size lot, half the money goes into perpetual care, and half goes into the cemetery, the capital improvement fund. Because it's a $300,000 project, we have $160,000. It is our recommendation that we ask the town for a loan from the general fund of $140,000. When I say we, I'm talking about myself and the current members of the Riverside trustees. They have worked with me on this project, as well as the town manager and the director of public works. How do we repay the loan for the general fund? Effective immediately, we would recommend that the lot cost for a full-size lot goes from $300 to $400, and a cremation lot goes from $150 to $200. For 11 years now, the cost of a cemetery lot has been $300 for a full-size lot. It is clear that does not cover the cost of the expansion of a cemetery, and we know that now better than ever because we have our bid prices in and so forth. Upon the expansion, lots at the cemetery for a full-size lot would be $500. The cremation lot would remain at $200 for now. I'm not comfortable right now making a recommendation for what a cremation lot would be. The town manager and I have discussed, I don't think he used creative, but he used some other term for the financing of how we would come about some quick cash.
Entrepreneurial financing.
Entrepreneurial. We would like to look at a reservation system in which anyone that would like to buy lots for the new section, it would be 400 $100 per lot for the first 300 lots sold. We're not sure how many residents would take advantage of it. We would hope that some would. That would, again, give us quick cash. As far as scheduling for the loan, we sell on the average 80 lots a year. If we take the 80 times 500, that's $40,000 a year. So it's my estimate in about 3.5 years, we would be able to pay back the $140,000 loan to the general fund. Please keeping in mind that for that 3.5 years, we would not put half those money into perpetual care. This is just simply to expedite the repay to the general fund. So with that, this evening, I would recommend that the council authorize the expenditure of $300,000 for the Riverside Cemetery expansion, $160,000 coming from the capital improvement fund for the cemetery, with a $140,000 loan from the general fund, understanding that Gorham Sand and Gravel would be awarded the bid, that we would increase the cost of a lot from $300 to $400 and $150 to $200 on the cremains, with the understanding that the opening of the first phase, once we're ready to get into the first phase of the cemetery, it would be $500 for a full-size lot, no matter if you're in the current section, which there would be a few lots available, or the new section, and that finally that we establish a reservation system at $400 per lot for the first 300 sold, all of those proceeds going back to repay the general fund loan.
Thank you, Debbie. Questions? Comments? Councilor Watson.
I have a question about on your letter regarding, it says, we need to carry a contingency fee for the project in the amount of $25,900, that's 10% plus or minus, and add this to the funding. Can you explain to me why we need to have that contingency of $26,000 when we've already have the estimate and we also are adding in another $20,000 for mapping lot markers and signage?
Mm-hmm. It's my understanding that about 10% is always carried for projects of this type. There might be change orders, Ruth. When the bid package was drafted, Maureen Sheridan, who was the professionals that we hired to do this, particularly with the ledge, they were trying to be very careful in how they estimated ledge and so forth. And going into that area, you just never know. So that, my understanding, is a standard of about 10% for a project of $300,000.
Okay,
and again, that's just one instance of something that may come up.
And the other concern I had is that we're going from we're allowing the first 300 people in this new section to buy in at $400, and after 300, we're going to charge $500. It seems to me that in essence, for anyone who comes at 301 and on, it seems almost like it's a late fee for not signing up earlier, and I understand the need to increase the rates, but I have a concern about increasing the percentage that we are, jumping from 300 to 500. 300 to 400 in the cremain lots, I don't have a problem with, but I do think that 500 is a significant increase. And I have a concern that we are now going to be placing ourselves at the top of the spectrum when you compare us to the other cemeteries around, that we're right up there with the most expensive ones. Versus at 400, we'd be right in with some of these. And we are maintaining a rural character, a rural sense. We're not a fancy, necessarily, cemetery. So I question whether we need to be at the high end, premier end for the lots. I have a concern about that.
If I may just speak to that for a moment. We've been anticipating this project for 5+ years, so we haven't moved on any increases in the lots and so forth. And I think it's safe to say that we probably should have moved forward with a slighter increase several years ago. Mm-hmm. And I would still believe that we would still come in now recommending the 500. That's just.
Other questions, comments? Councilor Fritz.
How much is set aside for perpetual care for each one of them? And how much would we lose, I guess, out of the 300 if all of that goes back to the general fund?
About 5 or so years ago, we started to put half. So for a full-size lot, it would be $150 into the perpetual care and $150 in the capital improvement. I think in the perpetual fund, we have $200 and something already, Carol. So again, we could still do half and half. But it would just take about 7 years to repay the general fund loan, and I personally thought it was a better recommendation to the council to try to get the loan paid off quicker.
Other questions? Hearing none?
I would like, I guess, to comment, Counselor Watson, you made, I've never, and you didn't say this, but it crossed my mind, I've never thought of death as a late fee. It was interesting. I put the two together in my mind, and I've got to think about that. Okay. Are we ready for a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Counselor Goff. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Counselor Reed. Further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Are there any against? One votes no, Counselor Watson. Okay, thank you very much. We're now moving to item 32, which is consider authorization of advancing refunding of the 1994 school slash town slash Portland headlight bond and the bonding of $400,000 for last year's purchase of the Levitt property, $330,000 for renovations to the second floor and the basement of the middle school, and $154,000 for the recently ordered fire truck. Mike.
Yes. Each of these projects have been previously authorized by the town council. The effect of this motion is several. One is that it will enable us to do an advanced refunding of the 1994 bond, which will save us about $120,000. The threshold limit for that is usually a 2% savings. We are currently slightly under that. We're hoping that from when this was drafted, the time we actually borrowed, it'll become close to that. One reason, though, that we're not as concerned, that we're not over the 2 as we otherwise would be, is the fact that we're also using this opportunity to save about $20,000 to $25,000. That we need to borrow for the Levitt property, for the fire truck, and for the middle school work. This is really a win-win. Would like to make another point in that this in no way harms the town's credit worthiness, even though if you read all the fine detail in it, it does indicate that because of the way an advance refunding mechanism will actually have the debt out twice. But because the markets know that it's in a secured escrow fund, the credit markets and the rating agencies know that, it does not in any way impair our credit rating. However, this will very much help our credit rating in that we have allowed this past year our general fund to go quite a bit lower than the target by purchasing the Levitt property. And we will by in the next month or so, when the fire truck comes in, our cash flow is significantly diminished. It's going to show up in our undesignated surplus. And taking this action tonight will greatly help that situation. And then when we go out to borrow the bigger dollars for the Levitt property, for perhaps the swimming pool and the police station, we'll be in a much better position. So the bond council drafted two separate motions, one for the $885,000 for the Levitt land for the middle school work and the fire truck, and another one authorizing the advance refunding.
And you're recommending both?
Recommending both.
Questions and comments?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
I noticed in the notes that if we don't get to close in time, we may lose the interest rate. How soon can this be accomplished?
I believe there was a schedule here. They're hoping to close in early September. But again, we may look at it then and the interest rates aren't favorable. We might say put it on the shelf.
We don't want to be locked into it.
Then. We wouldn't be locked into it. We would, if you look at here, in the end you authorize the council chairman and the manager to either to use their judgment to sign it.
Fine.
If the interest rates go skyrocketing, we lose our financial advantage and we won't do it.
Okay. With that caveat, I would move that both, we want to do them separately.
Go ahead with your motion. That's fine.
I'll move that both proposals be passed as read.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Watson seconds. Further discussion? Comments? Hearing none, let us vote. All those in favor?
Let us pray.
Are there any against? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mike. Item 33, consider approval of trustees submitted mission statement for the Thomas Memorial Library and receipt of the 5-year plan. What is the pleasure of the council?
Mr. Chairman, I did speak with Ann Swift-Kia today, the chairman of the trustees. She was unable to be here. I know the chairman himself had some questions, perhaps some other councilors. What I'd recommend you simply acknowledge receipt of this, which implies no action on it, and then if you want to revisit it at a later time, particularly considering the heat and the hour that you do that.
I would make that motion that we accept the mission statement submitted by the trustees of the Thomas Library and receipt of the 5-year plan.
I hear a motion. Is it seconded?
Sure, I'll second it.
Seconded by Councilor Groff. Discussion. Councilor Reed.
Shouldn't we be receiving the mission statement as opposed to accepting it? Accepting means we approve it. We didn't approve it because the chairman isn't here, and we want to reserve the right to review it with the...
I think I said submit as the submission, didn't I?
You said approve.
Accept.
I said accept.
Accept.
What was your intention, Councilor Berry?
Accept the submitted mission statement for the Thomas Memorial Library from the trustees. I did not intend approval.
Did we say accept or receive?
Acknowledge receipt.
Acknowledge receipt. Would you accept as an amendment, acknowledge receipt?
Put it that way if you like. Sure. All we want to do is accept it but not act on it.
That's
fine.
Okay. It's now moved, still seconded by Councilor Groff.
Sure.
Oh, was it you that had it, or was it, I'm sorry.
I don't remember.
Okay, Councilor Groff. Very good, thanks. Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Any against? Passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Item 34, receipt of report from the Ordinance Committee recommending a proposed addressing ordinance. Yes, who'd like to speak to this, please? Councilor McGinty.
On July 22nd, 98, the Ordinance Committee met. Councilor Groff was unable to attend due to a prior conflict he had. However, Councilor Fritz and myself reviewed the proposed addressing ordinance as presented by the town's addressing committee. You have it in front of you. It's somewhat detailed in some of the numbering proposals. However, I think it needs to be stressed that the key here is that the addressing committee will try to mitigate disruption to town residents by changing only those addresses where there is a compelling public safety need to do so, and by those other means practically available to it. And so what this does, it sets up for our new enhanced 911 emergency system, phone system. There's a requirement, a state requirement, that the addresses be set up in a certain way, odd numbers on one side of the road, even numbers on the other. And I won't go through all the specifics, but this ordinance addresses those needs by the state and will put in motion the addressing committee's effort to have our town comply with the addressing needs for the E-911. So.
Good questions for Councilor McGinty or Councilor Fritz or anything to do with that issue? Any other comments? Hearing none. All right, I hear a motion by Councilor Berry. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Watson. Thank you. Any further discussion?
Yeah,
Councilor Fritz.
Clarification. The motion is to set this to a public hearing at the regular September meeting at 7:30.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you. I'm sorry. You were going to say the same thing?
Yeah.
Excellent. Any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Are there any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Okay. Item 35. Consider the abatement fiscal year 97 taxes $107.85 for the Cape Insurance Agency as the result of an error in assessing the same personal property twice. Mr. McGovern, would you?
Yeah. What the assessor discovered in working with Deborah when she was trying to collect this is that it was under the same equipment was taxed under two different corporate names for the same entity. So the assessor himself under state law could abate the current year's taxes, but he couldn't go back, only the municipal offices to do that. So that's why it's on your agenda.
Thank you. Is there a motion? Councilor McGinty.
I move the abatement of the fiscal year 1997 taxes.
Thank you. And seconded by Councilor Berry. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, raise your hand. Any against?
You were,
yes, thank you. Okay, all it was unanimous. Thank you very much. Item number 36, consider vacancies to town boards and commissions.
Councilor Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have three items for consideration of the town council as a whole. And the first would be I would request that the town council approve the appointment of Penny Carson and Linda Beyer to replace two members of the Fort William Centennial Celebration Committee.
I second that.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? All those in favor? Any against?
Did that cover all your issue?
That's the first one. The second one is, I would ask that the town council appoint for the balance of an unexpired term, and since we are appointing in January for a new three-year term for this position, I would ask a three-year and four-month appointment for Rachel Stamietskin to the Thomas Memorial Library Board of Trustees, replacing a member who has left town.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you. And I would like to thank all those members who are departing for the different reasons, and thank the volunteers to fill those spots who so quickly came forward. The third item is a notice to the public that we are looking for two volunteers to serve on the Town Farm Committee. This ad hoc committee is charged with preparing and drafting and reviewing drafts of proposals that would create a special zoning district to protect the town farm on Spurwink Avenue. The property includes the open fields across from the entrance of the refuse disposal area and the land near the sewer treatment plant. The committee may prepare a draft conservation easement that would enable the property to receive additional outside protection. Two citizens are needed to be appointed, and there will also be representatives of the Planning Board, Conservation Commission, the Land Trust, and the Town Council. And I would ask that interested citizens please call Barbara Ray at the town office at 799-5251 as soon as possible, as the openings will close on August 31st. Also, just to let people know in terms of the scope of the duties, there will be a draft that is prepared for the Town Council to review in February, and then there will be probably a life of this committee to be no later than, what do you think? It's less than a year for the whole committee. So this is not a three-year or a two-year commitment. This is more like a six.
Much less than a year.
More like a three to six month commitment, and we would ask interested parties to please come forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Reed. Moving to item 37, consider entering executive session to discuss personnel matter and property land acquisition / disposition issues and collective bargaining with Local 340 of the Teamsters. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Fritz. Is there a second? Councilor McGinney seconds it. Any discussion? All those in favor? Any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you. Will we be returning, Mike, for anything? No, for those of you at home, we will not be returning into public session. Thank you very much.
I hope those people at home have a family.